Hello everyone. Welcome to the Panda's interview questions. Let me quickly give you a stats of how many number of interview questions are asked around Pandas. If you are a beginner and you are entering into data analysis or data scientist roles, the initial 30% of the questions that you are likely to face are going to be about Pandas and NumPy. These topics act as the basic element or criteria to judge and test one's knowledge. If you are unable to answer these very basic building block questions, the interviewer is very unlikely to further ask you questions about advanced machine learning or data science concepts. So this is why it is of utmost importance to prepare yourself for Pandas interview questions. The questions that I have added in this particular video are endorsed by 3,000 plus recruitment partners associated with IntelliPath. I believe these are the most important and common questions that are asked in interviews at MNCs or even startups. If you want to break into data scientist or data analyst job roles, make sure you watch this video till the end. So let's get started. So our very first question is a very simple one. What is Series in Pandas? So basically, whenever we begin with Pandas, this is the first thing we need to understand. Series is basically a one-dimensional array, right? It can hold data of any type. It can hold multiple data types. It is labeled by index, and it is similar to a column in a table. So basically, the easiest way to conceptualize a series is a single column in a table, which is why it's considered as one-dimensional, right? So this is the syntax of creating a series. So first we have to import pandas. And then what we do is we use pd.series, where S is capital, and then we pass A, where A can be a list or a tuple, right? So let's quickly go and implement it in our Jupyter notebook. So we'll go ahead and import pandas as pd. And then let's say, let's create a series called S, or let's create a series and store it in variable ser. We'll use the basic method of creating it, and then we'll pass a list and let the elements of the list be 0, 1. Let's use a null element. Let's use hello. Let's use complex element as well. Let's say 3, 2. Let's run it. Okay, NP is not defined, so let's go ahead and import NumPy as NP, and then let's run it. So let's print our series. So this is what our series is going to look like, right? So this is all about series. You can see this is a basic visualization of what series would look like. So here we have a string, we have an integer, we have a float, we have a date type, data type, and here we have a tuple. So we can have multiple data types in a series. Right? So our next question is again a very basic one. What is a data frame in pandas? So data frame is a two-dimensional data structure. It is mutable and it is heterogeneous as well. So what does this mean? Mutable as in we can add and delete rows in our data frame, but that is not possible in our series. Whenever we create a series, we cannot delete or we cannot add another data over here. We cannot add a row over here, right? But it is possible in case of data frame. We can add as well as delete rows. So it is mutable, size mutable, and it is heterogeneous in nature. Whereas series is homogeneous. Now, why is this? Because a data frame is a data structure constructed with rows and columns similar to a database or an Excel spreadsheet. So a data frame basically consists of a dictionary of lists where each list has its own keys or identifiers. Example, name, age, place, country, city, it could be anything, right? So basically, it can hold different types of data. It can hold numbers, strings, dates, similar to series. And the key component in data manipulation and analysis. So data frame is the key component when it comes to data manipulation. The syntax is again very simple. We use pd.dataframe, where D and F remain capital. And we can just pass our variable A, which is our data. So this is what a data frame looks like. Here we have our multiple columns, multiple rows. So this is basically a two-dimensional structure, right? We will also see the implementation in our Jupyter notebook. So I already had this data created, where I have data variable created, where it's nothing but a dictionary, and my first identifier or key over here is name, and associated to the name keyword is my list, where I have five elements, that is five names stored in my list. Similarly, I have age keyword, and I have five ages stored in this keyword. Similarly, I have profession, right? So let me go ahead and create a data frame with variable name DF, and I will just date. Let's look at the top five. Well, we already have five elements, so we can directly go ahead and print it. Right, so this is what our data frame will look like. So a third question is, how do you iterate over data frame in pandas? So in order to understand how we iterate over our data frame, first let's understand what iteration basically is. So it's a process where we access each item one by one in any storage type, right? It could be a list, it could be a tuple, it could be a dictionary, or even our data frame. So since we know that our data frames are built using rows and columns, and it follows a dictionary data type structure, so what we're going to do is we traverse our data frame by using the keys first and then the value for each keys. So this is what our iteration will look like. So let's go ahead and look at all the three iterations one by one. So let's look at all the three iteration methods one by one, right? So the first one is iter rows. So it is basically used to iterate over the rows of our data frame. So what iter rows function does is it will return the index and the data associated with each index. Let's look at our Python notebook and understand how iter rows works, right? So we already have a data frame stored in variable df. Let's go ahead and iterate over this df using iter rows. So we'll create two variables, index and the row in df dot iter rows. And then let's print index. And the row. Right, so this is what it's going to look like. At index 0, we have the name Ross, age 35, profession scientist. Let's see if that's the case. So yeah, we have at index 0, we have Ross, 35, and scientist. So this is being returned in a manner which is index, and our entire data at index 0, right? So this is what iter rows does. So the next one we have is ITER tuples. So ITER tuple works in a similar manner as ITER rows, but the only difference is while returning the index and the data in the particular row associated with that index, instead of returning it in a series like ITER rows, it will return it in a tuple format. Right, so let's go ahead and look how that's done. Let's say for row in ITER tuples, and then print row. Right, so this is basically a tuple over here, and we have our index 0. We have our name, Ross, age, profession, just like we had it over here. This is being returned in a series. This is a tuple, as you can see. Right, so that is the difference between ITER rows and ITER tuples. Now, third method to iterate over our data frame is the apply function. Right, so this method is used to apply a function along an axis of our data frame. Right, so let's see how that is done. Let's say I want to apply some kind of function for my age method over here. Let's say I want to square all the ages in my data frame. So I can easily do it with the help of apply method, right? So I will simply say df.age.apply, and then I will say np.sqrt, which is nothing but, so say I want to take the square root of all the ages present in my data frame, right? So all I have to do is use df.age.apply and then pass my function, which is np.sqrt, which is nothing but square root, right? So let's see, after running it, this is our output. So since I'm not making the change, since I'm not making this change in my actual data frame, this is just a temporary output. When I print my data frame, it'll still look like this, right? So this is how the apply function works. So our next question is, what is the difference between series and data frame? If you've understood the explanation for the first two questions, this question should be a piece of cake, right? So basically what we have, so the very first difference between a series and a data frame is the dimensions, right? A series is a one-dimensional data structure, whereas a data frame is a two-dimensional data structure. As we already saw, a series can only have one column, whereas a data frame has multiple rows associated with multiple columns, just like a spreadsheet, right? So, and the next difference is a series is homogeneous, which basically means single data, and a data frame is heterogeneous, which basically means multiple data. Now, what this means is, the main difference between a data frame and a series is that a data frame can have multiple columns, while a series can have only one. This means that a data frame can store more complex and heterogeneous data, while a series can store more simple and homogeneous data. Now, this does not mean that a series can store only one type of data. We've already seen that that's not the case. We can store strings, integers, floats, complex, even a null value in a series, just like data frame. But the thing is, it can have only one column. So that's where the homogeneous and heterogeneous come in the play. The next point we have is mutability. We've already discussed that series cannot add or delete data once it's created, so it is immutable in size, whereas a data frame can easily manipulate its data by adding and deleting rows as and when needed, right? So a data frame is clearly mutable in size. Another key difference between series and data frame is how they handle data alignment. Right, in a series, data alignment is index-based, meaning the operations align on the index labels. However, in a data frame, alignment is two-dimensional, occurring on both row and column. So this is where the single-axis labeling and two-axis labeling come in the picture. So the next difference is single-axis labeling and two-axis labeling. Now, what does this mean is when we deal with series data type, our data alignment is completely index-based, right? We access any index and we reach the data that we reach our target data. But that is not the case with a data frame. Data alignment in data frame depends on both the row indices and the column labels. So that is why data frame is a two-axis label, whereas a series is a single-axis label. And we already know the last one. A series is only a column of a data, whereas a data frame is a table of data, right? Next up, we have multi-indexing. Our next question is, explain multi-indexing in pandas. So what multi-indexing basically does is it creates a data frame with multiple levels of indexes. It represents a higher dimensional data in a tabular form. So where it comes into use is basically for handling complex data sets with hierarchical labels, enabling efficient data manipulation, selection, and aggregation across different index levels. Now, this might sound a little confusing here, but in simple terms, multi-indexing can be easily implemented in this manner, right? So let's do it for DF itself. Let's create another variable, let's say LST, and let's apply multi-indexing. Dot from frame, and we'll pass DF. So this is what LST will look like. It has all the data in the same structure. Like, our structure is same, right? We have Ross, then 35, then scientist, then next we have Rachel, 32, waitress. So the basic structure is similar, but what's happening here is it's storing it in the form of a list, right? So multi-indexing will basically allow us to access any element just with the help of indexing. Suppose I want to access Ross. All I have to do is use indexing and say 0,0, and here I have Ross. If I want to access this masseuse over here, all I have to do is LST -1, right? So I've used reversed indexing to access the last element over here. So this is what multi-indexing basically lets you do when you're dealing with a data frame. So our next question is, what is re-indexing in pandas? So now this is a very interesting one. So re-indexing, as you might have already guessed, it's basically a process of altering the index of a data frame or series to match a new set of labels. Now imagine we have a data set, we have a data frame containing the indexes as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 in this particular order, right? Now I want to change it to 3, 4, 2, 1, 0. This can be easily achieved with the help of re-indexing. So, but if I introduce a new index, say I introduce 100 to my existing data set, which only had indexes of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, then what's going to happen? It's going to create a row having null values. So let's try and implement it. So basically we apply re-indexing to our existing data frame in this manner. Let's say I want the new order to be 3, 4, 1, 2, 0. So you can see it's re-indexed now. The order has completely changed. So re-indexing also allows for handling missing data, aligning different data sets, and reshaping data structures to facilitate analysis. Right, so so what re-indexing does is it basically helps make our data more flexible for an analysis purpose, right? Next, our next question is difference between merge and concat. So this is a very interesting one because a lot of you might get confused when it comes to merge and concat. So what merge does is it combines two data frames based on keys. Now our keys are basically our column names. It could be a name, it could be a profession. So we can combine two data frames based on a common column, right? Whereas concat, it combines two data frames along a specific axis. It could be axis 0, which is for rows, or axis 1 for columns, right? So merge is similar to SQL join. Concat is not similar to join. It's more like stacking blocks, like H-stack or V-stack, right? Merge requires a key to join on. Concat does not require a key. Merge is highly flexible with merging conditions. Concat is comparatively less flexible. It is mainly for stacking. Like, it will not merge your data. It will just join. It will just combine it, right? Merge has the default axis, which is horizontal, and concat has default axis as vertical. So in order to merge a data set, let's create another data frame called data 2. And so I already had this one prepared. So what I'm doing is I have the common name, the names that we used in our first data frame, and I am adding a new column, which is marital status here, right? So let's create another data frame and so now in order to merge, let's create a new DF and let's say pd.merge, and we'll pass df2. Sorry, we're gonna merge df and df2, right? So this is our first data frame and this is our second data frame, and then we'll say on equal to name. So this is what our combined data after merging will look like. So our name, so basically our data frames have been merged based on the names, right? Since we had common names, we were able to add this new feature to the existing data frame, right? But if we were to do the same thing with the help of concat, let's see how that would turn out. pd.concat, and then we would pass df2, and then we would pass our axis because we want to merge it vertically along the columns. We'll pass our axis as 1, and we need to pass both our data frames in a list. Let's print it. So this is what it's going to look like. It's created it's added our df2, which is our name and marital status, but it did not merge the names here. It created another column for names and marital status, right? So what it did is it just picked up our second data frame and put it with the first one. So this is what concat does. If we were to change our axis to 0, this is what it would look like. We would have our names repeated here, and since we don't have any values for this, these top four values, we'll have null over here, and similarly we'll have null in these two features. So I hope this question is clear. So explaining categorical data in pandas. So basically, a categorical variable takes on a limited and usually fixed number of possible values. For example, gender, blood type, rating on a scale of 5. So when it comes to rating on a scale of 5, it could just be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Just 5 values. So categorical data is basically have fixed unique values. They help optimize our memory. They basically use lesser space since they're very limited, and it speeds up the operations, efficient for group buy and value counts, and they can be easily encoded to numerical types, right? They can be like, we have our example over here. We have 3 colors, red, blue, green. So they can be easily encoded to 0, 1 and 2. So this is gets really helpful when we're dealing with computations, right? So our next question is differentiating between map, apply map and apply. So here we have a very useful table for you to remember the application, the function type and the usage, but we'll discuss it in detail, right? So map function is used to substitute a value. So map function is basically used to substitute a value or map one value with another value. Say I have a feature column of yes and no's. But when I am dealing with any learning algorithms like linear regression or logistic regression, I would want that feature variable to have, instead of yes, say 1, and instead of no, say 0. So this is where map function would be really helpful, as I could easily convert all my yeses to 1s and all my no's to 0s. So this is how map function is used to substitute the values. So map basically uses a dictionary method to map the old values with the new ones. Our old values will be the keys and our new values will be the values in the dictionary, right? So this method is useful for only series and not data frames, right? So we've mentioned here it applies only to series. Next up, we have apply method. It is only applicable for a data frame. Our next function is apply. First, let's talk about apply and then we'll go to apply map. So apply works for series and data frame. So it is definitely more flexible. So it behaves similar to map when applying a function to each element. But when apply is used on a data frame, it can operate across rows and columns, right? So for example, if you want to calculate the mean or the sum across any column, you can easily use the apply method. Right, so it is useful for data frames. Our last method is apply map. So apply map is used only for data frames. Right, whenever you want to apply an element-wise operation across the entire data frame, we can use the apply map function. Suppose we want to convert all the strings to uppercase or operation similar to that, we can use the apply map function. Let's go ahead and quickly look at our Jupyter notebook. So let's make the changes in new DF dataset, right? So I have yes and no's over here in my marital status. Let's go ahead and let's apply the map function dot map, and we'll pass our yes and we'll say 1 and our no's equal to 0. So you can see this is our output. Similarly, we can use apply map function. Since we discussed that apply map is applicable for data frames, so let's go ahead and implement something that our entire data frame can implement, right? So let's create another data, another variable, and let's have name and profession, and let's say apply map, and let's not store the results in any variable. Let's directly print the output, and we can say lambda x, and let's return the length of each element in our data set, right? So you can see Ross has four length of four, Rachel has six, similarly Chef has four. So we have the length of each element in name and profession. We could have applied it to the entire data frame, but we would get an error for returning the length because age and marital status are already integers, right? So they wouldn't, they would throw an error. So that is why we've used only name and profession to apply this function. Next up, let's use apply. Next up, let's use the apply method. So let's say new df, and let's use the same two columns. Let's say apply, and let's pass the same function in as we passed an apply map. But what we have to do here is we have to pass an axis. So I want to do it across all my columns. So now you can see we have two in each output. Why is that? So if we try to print the length across axis 0, which is our rows, we're getting name as 5 and profession as 5, because we have 5 elements in our name feature and 5 elements in our profession feature. So this kind of applies the function to the entire axis and then returns the output. Instead of returning element wise, it does it the entire axis wise, right? So this is the difference between apply and apply map. Apply does it row or column wise, depending on the axis we pass. Our next question is, how can we convert a series to a data frame? So this is very simple. It can be easily done using two underscore frame and empty brackets, because it does not really need any parameter as such. But in case your initial series does not have a column name, you can just pass name equal to and your column name, or you can directly pass your column name, right? So this is how we can convert our series to a data frame. Our next question is, how do you convert categorical values in a column into numerical ones? So this can be achieved by two famous techniques, which is label encoding and one-hot encoding. So label encoding is a method for converting again categorical values into numerical values, so that our data can be used for analysis and modeling, right? So this method efficiently represents data numerically, which is necessary for any machine learning algorithms. So let me show you. This is what label encoding will look like. We have a column of colors, a feature of colors, where we have different colors like red, blue, green, purple, right? So if we want to represent these string values into numerical ones, we can use label encoding, and we can assign each color a unique numerical value. What we've done here is we've assigned 0 to red, 1 to blue, 2 to green, and 3 to purple. So this is how label encoding works. Similarly, we have one-hot encoding, which one-hot encoder basically creates a new binary column indicating the presence of each possible value from the original data. Now you can see what's happening here. It's created color red, color blue, color green, and color purple, different feature columns separately for each color. So now what it's doing here is, suppose we had red over here and red over here in the end again. So we would have one over here and one over here as well, indicating the presence of red twice. But since we have only unique colors over here, so our ones are present only once in each feature. So we have one color red, one color blue, one color green, and so on. Let's look at the implementation in a Jupyter notebook. Right, so in order to perform label encoding in pandas, all we have to do is, let's consider our DF data frame. We have profession here, right? So let's assign each profession a unique numerical value. So all I have to do is DF profession, and let's say PD dot categorical, and then DF profession, because this is the profession is the column that I want to convert into numerical values, right? So I just have to say dot quotes, and then let's print DF. So you can see each profession has a unique code, which is starting from 0 and ending at 4, right? So we can figure out that accountant has 0, chef has 1, masseuse has 2, scientist has 3, and waitress has 4. So this is how label encoding works in pandas. We can also do it in using sklearn, and we can just call label encoder and easily fit our data set using fit transform. But we won't go into that because we're covering pandas. So this is how you can do label encoding in pandas. Similarly, we can perform one-hot encoding in pandas using dummies method, right? So let's see how it is performed. Let's see how we can perform it. So we'll create, we'll store it in another variable, say df, or let's create another variable dummy. And so we'll create another variable dummy, and let's call the dummies method using get dummies, and we have to pass df. And what column we're targeting here is professions. We have to pass it in a list, and we'll say the d type to be int, right? Let's see what the dummy variable looks like. And as you can see, we have Chandler 1, profession 0. Okay, instead of profession accountant, profession. Okay, since we had already converted our DF over here. Okay, so this is why we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 here. Okay, let's not actually make the change in DF itself, but let's do it in, say, label. Okay, so this is an error that we made. Where is our DF? We will have to rerun it so that okay, so now let's run it again. So we have profession accountant, profession chef. Okay, so this is what one hot encoding looks like. So our next question is, why should standardization be performed on data? So first, let's understand what standardization is. So standardization is a feature scaling technique, right? Why do we need feature scaling? Whenever we have a data set that contains a lot of outliers, or it contains values like I have, it contains features like age and then salary. So age and salary are going to differ very dramatically, right? age would lie somewhere between 0 to 100 and salary could range somewhere between 0 to billions, trillions and whereas salary could range somewhere from 0 to billions or trillions. So this is where the huge gap between the features comes into play. So this is where we require feature scaling, and one of the methods of feature scaling is standardization. So what standardization does is it helps bring all the data to the same scale. It is crucial for machine learning algorithms because when there are larger data along with data having smaller magnitude, there is bias and domination of the larger data, right? Data having more magnitude. So what standardization does is it rescales our data around mean 0 and standard deviation 1. So this is the formula. It basically uses the Z-score formula, and this is how standardization is performed. So moving on, name some statistical functions in pandas. So the main statistical functions we have is mean, median, mode, standard deviation and variance. So these can be easily implemented. Let's implement it on df.h. This is our h. Let's implement mean, right? Let me just copy this so that I don't have to type it again and again. Let's print standard deviation, std. Let's print variance, var. Let's print, what were the other functions? Median, mode, right? So let's print median. Let's print mode. So since all the values are occurring only once, there is no maximum repeating value here, right? So these are the statistical functions we have. Our next question is, how do you split a data frame according to a Boolean criterion? So whenever we have a Boolean criteria splitting our data set, it is usually called Boolean masking or Boolean indexing. So what this basically means is we create a separate data frame based on a condition, right? We filter our data based on a condition, and that condition is usually applied using double equal to sign, right? So we can see here it's written, we apply the Boolean series to the data frame. This step basically splits our data frame into two parts, one where the condition is true and one where it is not, right? It is true and false. So let's see how masking is achieved in Python. So let's create another variable, say mask, and let's say where we have our profession equal to, let's say, accountant. Let's print mask, and we have our accountant profession at index 3. Let's visit in the index 3, and Chandler is having that profession, right? So we have true over here. So this is how masking is done in Python using the double equal to sign. Our next question is, how do you optimize performance while working with large data sets in pandas? So optimizing a performance is very crucial when we're working with larger data set. Otherwise, it could have a serious impact on our runtime, and it could be really time consuming. So our first step would be to use efficient data types. Efficient data types are basically the correct data types, right? For example, using an integer data type for a column that contains only numeric values would be more viable or more feasible than using a string data type for that particular feature column, right? Our next step would be to reduce the data size. Now, our data size can be reduced by implementing compression techniques like optimizing our image data and caching and so on, right? The third operation that we can do is using vectorized operations. So vectorized operations are a very important feature of Python, which allow you to apply a function or an operation to multiple elements of an array, a vector, a data frame at once, and instead of using a for loop. So what vectorized operations do is basically, instead of applying a for loop or a while loop to your entire vector, array, or data frame, you can do it in one single step using vectorized operations. And you can do it to perform multiple operations like multiplying elements of any data structure, right? It saves a lot of time, it improves your code readability, and it also reduces memory storage, memory usage. And our last one is leverage chunking. So how leverage chunking works is basically, the first step is to divide the data set. So whenever we have a very large data set, we first split it into chunks. It could be multiple chunks depending on the number, on the size of our data set, right? Then the next step is sequential or parallel processing. Once we have our data set into chunks, we can process it either sequentially or parallelly. Usually parallel processing is much faster. So depending on that, we can use our processing technique. And then the last step is to combine the results, which is basically aggregating or combining all our results from all the smaller chunks that we got of our data sets, right? So this is how we can optimize performance while working on larger data sets in Pandas. Our next question is, what is data aggregation in Pandas? So data aggregation basically refers to the process of summarizing, combining, or grouping data to extract meaningful insights, right? It basically involves aggregate operations like sum, mean, min, max, count, etc. on groups of data, right? So whenever we, let's go ahead and quickly, like this is one example of an aggregate function, right? We had these multiple values and we took the average of all these values using an aggregate function called mean. Similarly, we could perform a sum, and this is what aggregate functions look like. So our next question is, how will you sort a data frame? Now, sorting is basically rearranging your data in a way that either you have smallest to largest or largest to smallest, right? So this can easily be done by using the sort_values function. And then we have our first parameter, that is by. We have to pass our column name, like which column, regarding which column we're sorting our data frame, our data set. Then we need to pass ascending equal to true or false, depending on our requirements. And then we have in place equal to true or false. In place is basically, it will change our data frame in its place, like we will have permanent changes in our data frame, right? So our next question is, what's the difference between interpolate and fill NA in Pandas? So interpolate is basically a technique which is used to estimate or calculate a data point, an unknown data point, between two known data points, right? Whereas fill NA is more of a method that lets you fill all the null values or replace all the null values with another value. It could be any specified value, right? One use case of interpolation is filling the gaps with estimated values, whereas fill NA will fill the gaps with a constant value that is passed by the developer or the coder, right? Which is passed by you. Let's look at how interpolation works. Right, so first let's create a series. So let's say we have 0, 1, 2, and then np.nan, and then another value, let's say 4, right? So if we say s.interpolate, okay, I'm sorry, the n should be small. So when we interpolate our series s, So this null value gets replaced by 3 over here. So this is what interpolation does. It has calculated the basic jump each value is taking, and then it has filled the null value with repeat, and it has filled the null value accordingly. Right? We can now, if we were to use fill NA over here, we would have to manually pass a value. Say I would pass 0 to fill my null value. So this is what my series would look like after interpolation and after using fill NA method. Right, so these are two methods to fill the missing values or to impute the missing values, right? So our next question is, how can we use pivot and melt data in pandas? So the pivot function in pandas is a method that is used to reshape data by transforming rows into columns. So basically what pivot does is it rearranges data from a long format to a wide format, right? So this is the syntax used for dataframe.pivot. It takes the index, columns and values. So basically, we could have our data frame. Let's go ahead and look at our Jupyter notebook and implement it. Say we have df.pivot. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my index as profession, and I'll take my columns as my age, as the age in the data set, and I'll take values as names. Let's go ahead and print it. So now you can see we have our index as profession and we have our columns as the age, and we can easily figure out a chef age 30 is Monica. So we have completely rearranged our data, right? This is what our data looked like, where we had our name, age, profession, and this is what it looks like after pivoting our data frame, right? So the next technique is melt, which is basically used to unpivot or transform our data set back into the long format. Right, so it will reshape data by converting columns into rows. It is the complete opposite of pivoting, right? So this is the syntax where we use dot melt, and then we pass our id vars and then our value vars, like our index variables and our value variables. Let's go ahead and implement it, right? So pd dot melt, and then we'll pass our data frame, and then we'll pass our id vars, which is age, and then we'll pass our value vars, which is our profession feature and name feature, right? So now you can see we have our age as our ID, and then we have our variables, which is first is profession. So we have a profession for each age that we have as our index, and then we have the names for each age as our index, right? So this is what melt does. It has converted our data frame into a long format. This was a wider format, this is a long format. So I hope the difference is clear and you guys have understood how we use pivot and melt data in pandas. Now our next question is, how do I calculate different quantile ranges in pandas and the mean, median, mode, variance and standard deviation, right? So we've already seen whenever we want to calculate mean, median, mode, standard deviation, we just have to use these methods like df dot our feature name such as age and then dot mean, and we get the output, right? How do we calculate different quantile ranges in pandas? So in order to calculate the different quantile ranges, all we have to do is, suppose we want to calculate the quantile ranges for our feature age. So all we have to do is call the describe method, and we have so pandas already provides all these calculations. You don't have to do them manually, you don't have to apply any formula. So this is another advantage of Python. Sorry, this is another advantage of pandas. You have your minimum, you have your first quantile, this is 25%. You have your median, which is 50%. You have your 75%, and then you have your maximum, right? So you can easily check your quantile ranges using the describe method. Your next question is, how do you make label encoding using pandas? So we have already seen the hands-on in our Jupyter notebook for the same. We can quickly go through this screenshot where we have a data frame of one column, which is color, and we have different colors, which is red, blue, green, and then blue, red. Okay, so blue and red is being repeated here. And then we've done the similar, we've used the similar function, which is pd.categorical, and then we pass our color column, and then use dot codes to generate the codes for all the colors. So as you can see, the output over here, we have red, which is given the value 2, and similarly you can see on the fourth index we have red, which is given the unique number 2, right? So any number of times that red appears in our data, we're gonna have the code as 2 for it. Similarly, we have the code 0 for blue, as you can see here, and 1 for green. Our next question is, how do I create a box plot with pandas? So a box plot basically gives the statistical 5 number summary, namely the minimum, the first quantile, which is 25%, the second quartile or the median, which is 50%, third quartile, which is 75%, and the maximum, right? As you can see in this graph here, these are the whiskers. This is the minimum. This is our first quartile, 25%. This is our median. This is our 75%. This is our maximum, right? So in order to create a box plot, first what we have to do is we have to import matplotlib.pyplot as plt. And then we just have to say plt.boxplot, and we'll pass df.age, and let's say plt.show. So you can easily create a box plot in 2 lines of code, right? So moving to the next question, how do you check and remove duplicate values in pandas? So in order to check your duplicate values, you just have to use the method df.duplicated, and to remove the duplicate values, you just have to use the method df.drop_duplicates. Simple enough, right? Our next question is, how do you add a row to a pandas data frame? Now this can be done using 2 methods. One is using loc, log function, and the other one is using append, right? But this is not just append, this is ._append, okay? So let's go ahead and look at the implementation. So let's say df.loc, and we only have, okay, we don't know the length of our data, so we'll just pass length of df, and we'll add another name, say abc, I don't know any name. We'll add another age, and we'll add a profession, say cook. Let's check our df. So we have another row added. Now let's try it with df.append. Let's repeat this so that we don't waste time typing another row of code. Okay, so I forgot to pass the access. Whenever we're appending, we need to clarify which access we want to append it to. So this by default got appended over here. I wanted it to get appended at access 0 over here, right? So I will just go ahead and quickly restart my notebook so that I can get the desired output, right? Okay, so whenever we're using append, we need to use the dictionary format because append has no idea what which value is, so we need to pass it in this manner, right? And then we say our age is 25 and we say our profession is cook and okay, so also we need to pass a very important parameter, which is ignore index equal to true, and voila, we have a seventh row added to our data frame, right? So these are the two methods using which we can add a row to the pandas data frame. How do you create time delta objects in pandas? So first of all, let's understand what time delta objects are. So basically, a time delta object represents a duration or a difference between two date time or date instances, right? So as you can see here, the syntax is just pd.timeDelta, and inside the parentheses, we can pass any time constant, which will then be converted to the right format. So let's try it out. So let's create a variable delta and let's call it pd.timeDelta. Sorry, the d will be small. And let's say 2 days, 2 hours, 15 minutes, and let's say 30 seconds. On printing the output, it directly converts our 2 hours, 15 minutes, 30 seconds to a proper timestamp, right? So this is what time delta does. So our next question is, what do describe percentiles value represent? So as we already discussed, whenever we represent our first quartile, it represents this line, which is our 25th percentile. When we say median, it is our 50th percentile, and 75th percent is our third quartile over here. This is our minimum value, this is our maximum value, right? So Q1 and Q3, so using Q1 and Q3, we can easily calculate our minimum and maximum values, right? So whenever we use describe, this is what is being given to us as an output, right? Moving on to the next question, what is the difference between iloc and loc? So iloc is basically integer-based indexing and loc is a label-based indexing. So whenever we use loc, we usually pass our feature name or our column name. Whereas when we use iloc, we pass our index, right? It's used to access rows and columns, but iloc accesses the rows and columns by their position, whereas loc accesses rows and columns by their names. The syntax is df.iloc row index, column index, whereas loc has a syntax of df.loc row label, column label. Example, you can see here, it's very clear. So this is basically the difference between iloc and loc. right? Moving on to the next question, what is vectorization in pandas? So we already discussed vectorization is a series of operations that is performed on an entire array, vector or a data frame without using any explicit loops. Since we already discussed what is vectorization in pandas, we'll just quickly go through it once again. So vectorization refers to the operations that are performed on an entire array, vector or a data frame without using any loops. So this saves us a lot of time and it is more efficient and also increases the performance, right? So these are some of the benefits of vectorization. So vectorization is basically any operation that we perform, like multiplication between two arrays or tensors or vectors, right? How can you merge two data frames? So we've already seen the merge operation that we have performed using the two data frames, where we merge two data frames based on a similar key, on a common key, right? Or a common feature. So it takes two data frames as parameters and allows us to combine them. This is what merge does, and we've already performed the hands-on. How will you combine different data frames in Panda? So we've already looked at concatenation and merge, and the third one is join. So we use df our data frame 1 dot join, and then we pass our second data frame, and then we tell how we want the data frames to be joined. It could be a left, right, outer, inner, right? So let's look at the hands-on. We'll also quickly revise merge. Right. So this is how we performed merge. We merged our two data frames, our data sets, using this keyword name, and then we added a new feature called marital status, right? Similarly, perform concatenation. We can do it on different axes, either 0 or 1, right? Now we'll quickly go ahead and look at join. So let's say I want to join df with df2. I have to pass my l suffix, which will be df, and my r suffix, which will be df2. So let's run it, and you can see it's the features that were common in both the data frames have been renamed to name df for the first data frame and name df2 for the second data frame. So this is how we know that this particular set of data belongs to df2 and this particular set of data belongs to our first data frame, right? And since we didn't really have a fifth row in our second df, so it's a null value over here, right? So this was our last question for this video. I hope you understood the concepts clearly and you will be able to answer these types of questions in your interviews. Thank you for watching, and do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the thumbs up button. See you in the next video.